Hello and welcome to Goa 365 discussion on the national budget. Today was the second budget presented by our finance minister. Now with us, we have a distinguished panel to discuss this budget, to give our audience in all over the place details about the budget, what and how, the nuances, maybe something good, something bad. With us, I would like to introduce the panel. With us is the GCCI Goa Chamber of Commerce Vice President, Mr. Ralph D'Souza. Sir, welcome.
Thank you.
Second is immediate past president of the GCCI, Chartered Accountant Sandeep Bhandare. Sir, welcome. With us is Mr. GSI President, Mr. Kochkar. Mangirish Pai Raikar, associated with SOCHM. And Parimal Kurkarni, Chartered Accountant also and Chairman of the Taxation Committee of the GCCI. Sir, welcome to this discussion on the budget on Goa 365. I would like to start with you, Mr. D'Souza. Now, could you give us an overall, feel of the budget, looking at it October, coming out of COVID, possibly. Yes.
Yes, definitely. It's a difficult budget in the sense that, as you said, we are coming out of the budget, and we have done pretty well coming out of it. India, with all the infrastructure we have, the population we have, it was expected to be one of the biggest victims of this COVID. But we have come up, and today we are one of the fastest recovering nations. And our fatality also is very low compared to others, even the developing nations. So I think a lot of credit goes to our health workers, who have done a tremendous job in spite of the shortcomings in our infrastructure that we have in medical field. We have done beautifully and wonderfully. Well, last year the budget was stressed again on reforms, on development in terms of infrastructure, as well as ease of doing business. Much was to happen but did not happen because of the lockdown, because of the downturn in the economy as a result of COVID-19. And there were a lot of revenues that were not met with, the targets were not met with. So as a result of this, many development schemes that were in the pipeline did not come into existence. This year we are entering the financial year now on a positive note, where we are putting the fear and the shortcomings of COVID behind us. So again, I consider that this budget is a continuance of last year's budget, where again the stresses on reforms, on infrastructure, on ease of doing business, on other parameters, development parameters, even maybe healthcare especially, now we have to give it a boost. So a substantial amount of the budget is allocated to healthcare and to education as well. We were also very happy to see, of course, normally whenever the budget is presented, the common man looks at the income tax slab, whether he's getting a relief or not getting a relief. But in this case, we are happy that the burden has not increased, because we cannot expect any relief in a situation like this where the funds are so scarce. So we were worried, we were just thinking, will cess be imposed now, will some direct taxes increase, maybe imposition here, imposition there, in order to meet up the expenses. Nothing of this happened. So in one side, we have got allocations, enhanced allocations towards whatever the budget stands for, the development as well as the infrastructure. On the other hand, the taxes have not increased.
Yeah, I would like to speak.
I would say that it is a very balanced budget. Although it's a difficult time, it's extremely balanced budget.
Yeah, I would like to now, since Mr. D'Souza has already spoken about taxes and taxation, Mr. Parimal and you, so I would like to start with you, Mr. Bhandare. Could you give us details specifically on the taxi? For a common person, even for me, first thing you look at is taxes, be it direct, be it indirect. So we would like to give you shed some light on it.
As Ralph said, there were fear that, considering the fiscal situation that we are having now, the government may have to resort to the additional income tax. And we have this kind of a dichotomy that on one side the economy has taken a beating and you find that you know a lot of job losses have occurred and other things. And on the other hand, you found that the stock market had increased tremendously from March 2020, where the NSE index had gone down to something like 7,500. We were in the area of almost 14,300. So one kind of thing which was being tossed around was the idea that perhaps this capital gains could be taxed, or perhaps you know dividends could be taxed, so that you know we would have this kind of an additional income available with the government. And that was a fear, and that was why we found that for the last 5 days, when the stock market had gone down, thinking that finance minister would definitely impose this kind of any taxes. So thankfully what has happened was is like this, the tax rates have not been touched at all. So we have this situation where the last year's taxation system also continues
currently. Specifics, Mr. Vandar?
That we have got, for example, for an individual, the slab was 2.5 lakh rupees, beyond which the tax was being levied. And then from 2.5 lakhs to say 5 lakhs, and from 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, and 10 lakhs and above was the kind of scheme. And a relief was given last year where one income was up to 5 lakh, there was no taxation. So these kind of reliefs have continued to be there existing. Similarly, for the companies, the rate was decreased from the 25% plus surcharge plus cess to a 22%. And in case of new manufacturing companies, the rate was 18% plus surcharge and the cess. So that also has not been touched. So these are the two good things which are there. Now, in addition to that, certain other things have been there. For example, a dividend, there was a TDS issue,
yes,
which as is, you know, TDS also can be put at the other TDS, TEDIOES. So very cumbersome kind of procedure. So that is getting avoided from this thing. People who have crossed 75 years now, you know, they need not file the returns, and there could perhaps a system whereby the tax would be automatically recovered by the banks and other institutions. Again, government's right to go into the past disputes is, you know, they have curtailed the right from the 6 years to 3 years, where the assessment could be reopened, except in very, very grave kind of a situation. So overall, what we find was that, you know, taxation has not been touched at all, and this is what the market is very happy about. The situation, and some kind of a roadmap is there. Again, one of the area was income tax appellate tribunal. Now, government said that in order to reduce corruption, we will start from faceless assessment, then the scheme reached to faceless appeal, and now they are saying even at income tax appellate tribunal, we will try to have faceless kind of appeal at that level also. So, whole thing is like mechanizing, automating to the process to the extent possible, reducing corruption, introducing transparency, and I think we are moving in a very good direction as far as the taxes are concerned.
Yeah, Mr. Parimal, now you are also a tax expert, you're heading this committee. So I would like your inputs also on both direct and indirect specifically, including companies, relating to something about Companies Act.
As he has pointed out on the direct tax front, on the indirect tax front also they have not fiddled with too much on the GST rates or anything now. And custom duty tariffs, and there is an agriculture development cess which is planned on the imports. So as such, the Indian public has not been too much disturbed. And what they do during the budget over the last 3-4 years, we have been seeing since GST, is GST is no longer a budget related thing. It's more related to during the year they give notifications, or during the year they bring in reliefs, or they bring in the restrictions. And they have been making continuous changes to the law because they want it settled as soon as possible. Now it's almost 3.5 years to 4 years of the law, it is not yet settled. However, the continuous effort is going on, and even in this budget we are seeing that they have made some major changes as far as GST audits are concerned. They are trying to omit the law and bring it part of an self-assessment mechanism, as well as the input tax credits they are planning to change, wherein, so rather than just increasing the taxes, they are trying to plug the loopholes which are possible, so that if they can save on the, or they can reduce the loopholes, maybe the taxation system can be more value-added and streamlined. This is as far as the indirect tax regime, but I think custom duty rates are being changed. So that we will have to see the annexures in detail to further comment on them. As far as the Companies Act is concerned, I think a year or two ago they did bring down the rates to the lowest in the world, as they say, 15% for manufacturing and 22% in other cases. So that relief was already there earlier. Maybe the results of it couldn't be seen during the COVID time. So that may be seen now. So their focus appears to be to get the business moving and the business to generate the taxes. So that's where probably the ministry is still comfortable with the deficit, but not wanting to tax the industry more at this point of time. That's a very difficult
forward looking, but forward looking also.
A forward looking decision. So,
yeah, yes. Because even like 9.5 fiscal deficit, if I am not which is in this, I think possibly it could be forgiven or overlooked. But what I wanted to get was that there is a new Companies Act, wherein you can have one person company and all. If you could give some light on this, shed some light on this.
The one person company rule was already there earlier.
Okay, but I don't think many of us were aware of it.
They were not aware of it. Many have in metros and all, this benefit has been taken and they have incorporated.
Okay.
They are planning to bring in some new changes because of this one person companies. Like even non-residents are being allowed to be set up one person companies, and they'll reduce the compliances required, as well as to smaller companies also. They have rechange the threshold limit from 50 lakhs of paid up capital to 2 crores,
mm-hmm.
and turnover they have made to 20 crores.
Mm-hmm.
So that way what happens is the Indian taxation system, people would prefer remain in individuals or as partnerships, would now want to be more a formal sector through a corporate entity. And that would be good for the Indian international standing of Indian companies also. So
yes.
those changes are there, but again these changes would be have to be looked into the budget for what are the minute details
nuances, yes,
bring into them.
Yeah,
but this is a good thing, means it was required. So classification of smaller companies up to 20 crores, I think this was necessary.
Yeah, so okay. Yeah, thanks as well.
Yeah.
Mr. Kochkar, now you are specifically industry, hardcore manufacturing, etc. So what exactly would this budget have brought for you on a national level generally, as well as what would you want also, or how could it translate into some help to you if it might, and possibly maybe in the local budget some loophole, something extra could be taken up?
Yeah, if you see the overall situation, as you have mentioned earlier, we came out recently from the COVID situation.
Correct.
So we were also not sure what government is going to do. Now, amount of infrastructural improvement and amount of investment they have got into all the sectors, this will certainly allow MSME to also to pitch in and produce something.
Hmm.
See, when the money flows from the government side, entrepreneurs always take the opportunity to go and capture that. That is one good sign. Then other part of this thing was, we were worried that the taxation might increase.
Mm.
And there may be lot of additional burden which they have not done. We were not expecting any reduction as such right now, but at least the fair playing field was what we had envisaged in this budget, which I feel is a very good thing. And many they talked about labor codes, which has been introduced, which will help industry to streamline. Even women are allowed to work in night shifts.
Yes,
which has been our demand, which specific to certain industries, Goa government had allowed. But now if it comes from the central, it will be a very good sign, provided we take a proper care about the other
safety, aspect,
safety part of it. It is a good time. Minimum wages also, they have made it that we have to see how it will affect us, because minimum wages they have raised from the all sectors, unskilled, skilled also.
Okay.
So that slab we'll have to see how they want to propose it. But that also, I feel, see, in short, what they are trying to do is a person who is doing a fair business, he'll get a better deal. In this whole scenario, the person who is ready to comply with all the rules and regulation will get a fair deal.
What about labor laws? The labor law reforms are long overdue. I don't know. That's
It's almost now 10 years, I think.
Yeah.
And it has been cleared in the Lok Sabha also.
Correct.
But it will come up. Because still then this our government again try to play a mischief with this labor laws.
Correct.
They could have waited for maybe some more time, because it's in a pipeline.
Mm-hmm.
And this will try to, you know, ease of the compliances.
Ease of doing business
is a major thing, because right now if a small entrepreneur has to start any business, he has to go through at least 23 different compliances.
Million. When it becomes very 23 difficult. Is like a million almost.
Yeah, same information you have to give it to different departments like factories and boiler, you give same information, labor also you give same information. So this way, if it is done on one single portal, then it will be easier for the manufacturer or anybody to start do a business.
Yeah, this ease of doing business, I want to bring it up a little further. But Mangesh Bab, I want now education, you are somewhat connected besides management. So I want you to give us some input on infrastructure, education and permissions on the software sector, not just hardcore manufacturing, like services and all.
See, I think my colleagues have already touched based on what the budget is like, you know. I would like to also, you know, touch base on what you have said, including the takeaways from what the budget has told us, you know. Yes, they have laid a specific interest in education, because the new education policy has been introduced very recently. The thrust is more on vocational education. The thrust is more on skilling part of it.
Yes.
And
yes,
for the skilling part of it, there is a lot of budgetary provisions which have been made to fortify the new education policy which is recently launched. Another thing which is very, very important, which is the part of the new education policy, is to go for innovation. Because they talk about science, they talk about technology, because from science it is technology, from technology it is innovation, and from innovation it is commercialization. Now, what do we do? Is to, you know, have innovate a product and then commercialize it, which will benefit the society at large. So, to do that, for research purpose, government has put in lot of money in this budget. If you have seen, if you analyze today, the total expenses in the research and development, government is doing almost 58%. The rest comes from the private sector. So that has to be actually, you know, the reverse way. But still, government has felt that since it is not forthcoming from the private sector, they have increased their contribution in the research center. Now coming to the, because I also head the MSME in ASSOCHAM, so I would like to make two-three takeaways from what this budget has said. First of all, they have done, spending. You know, if you have seen the economic survey which was presented last week, what it says and what it depicts and what the economists feel about it. You know, what economists felt about it was, although the fiscal deficit is bound to increase, okay, because of this COVID spending and all that, and we are in a difficult situation. We are not yet come out of it.
No.
Although the vaccines are seen the light of the day, but it will take some time. By the time everybody gets vaccinated, everybody gets the benefit of that. But then, till that time, we need to. So they have given good provision for the healthcare sector, which is very, very good. And second aspect is for MSME. They have, you know, the spending, especially in infrastructure. As he said, it's going to be very, very good, because this spending in infrastructure is going to be cascading.
Correct.
And it is going to, you know, also take the money in the pockets of the migrant labor, in the pockets of the labor who are not going to keep it at the house. They're going to spend it. And when they spend it, you know, there are different versions of it. They spend it for transport, they spend it for food, they spend it for medicine, they spend it for clothing, they spend it for entertainment and everything. And very, you know, there is an economic turnaround which will try to happen. Now, another plus point I would like to tell you. Last month, if you have seen, 1,20,000 crores have been collected by GST.
GST, yes, it's gone up.
This is happening for last 3-4 months. Now, if you calculate that, it is going to be 14 lakhs per year. Now, if it is going to be 14 lakhs per year, the turnaround of it would be addition to the gross revenue of the country. And it is going to increase almost to the extent of 19%. And if it happens, you know, that our turnaround would be faster than any other country in the world.
Yes.
And we will reach that 5 trillion mark, as it is envisaged and as it is targeted. Secondly, why I am telling you, just 1 minute, where MSME is going to be the cause for it.
MSME has got a resilient nature. They come out fast because they are small. They can turn around fast. So what happens is, you know, today, if the MSME is given opportunity, now what happens is there are 3,000 products which are imported from neighboring countries. They are not, it's not a rocket science to manufacture those products. So government has given stress on import substitution. And they have given lot of stops for it also.
Yeah.
They are supporting it. So if it happens, naturally, you know, we are going to take care. I'll give only three examples. One is, you know, we were not having PP kits. We were not having sanitizers. We were not having ventilators. We are manufacturing all those things. On the contrary, we are exporting that.
Correct.
So simultaneously, yeah, we will have all those products which we'll manufacture for our use
and for
the, for
yes,
the exports.
Absolutely. Tourism, ease of busy, doing business on tourism, and then we can leave it open not only from infrastructure, also from the taxation side. So we start with you specific, because see, tourism for Goa, it is tourism, I don't think, and
see,
pharma, of course.
Yes, of course. This has
and we have an issue with toilets on the beaches. I always, every debate that topic comes up. Yes.
Okay, now there's another thing that you missed out is the imposition on imports. Import duties have increased. That has got far-reaching effect on the local economy. One is the local produce will be protected.
Correct.
Secondly, there is enough population for consumption, so
yes,
production also will increase.
Should
so
increase,
all
yes.
All this thing, the primary sector will get a boost. Because
yes,
if you go to see all these impositions, you have to see the idea that he has now, rough idea, that they are for goods that can be produced here and which is produced by the small scale industry. As far as tourism is concerned, there is not much that we saw directly for tourism, but we'll see if there is anything in specifications in the agendas or something of that sort. See, tourism is an industry that is first to get affected and last to recover.
Yes.
Because
it's confidence based.
It is to do with human beings. Okay. And if we should not be in a tearing hurry to start it, because there should be a control of epidemic, then you can start it. Otherwise, there can be a second coming, which will put this further into
it's happening in UK and Brazil.
But we have done quite well as far as that is concerned.
Touch
the
wood.
Whole scenario has changed now because of visa restrictions and flight restrictions. Goa depends upon international tourists. We don't have that coming, so our full focus is on the domestic tourism. And somehow or other, the people who, a lot of Indians travel abroad, they say they cannot travel abroad, that they come into Goa. This is the first choice of destination. So that is happening, and we hope that this lot of rooms also available, which are also international.
Yeah.
People are prone,
yes,
also in domestic.
Yeah.
See, now the union budget is there, and the Goa government has to reciprocate in that way. See, when so much investment has been planned there, anybody to start business, there has to be a proper ease of doing business here. They have to set up clear-cut indication to the investor that we will be welcoming manufacturing units here. That is the first thing. That assurance right now is not there.
Yes.
That confidence has to be built up by the Goa government. Because otherwise all the investment will go to the other states.
Go somewhere else, yes.
So that is
very important.
That is,
and with that,
then we have to back up with the infrastructure.
Yes. Yeah. And more importantly, I feel from what feedback we get is ease of doing business. Basically,
yeah,
you go there and then you will call me and then you will call me and then you will call me and then you feel.
Whom to contact.
Exactly.
You know? So it has to be clear cut and transparent.
You will be surprised at the number of calls we get. Are please speak to this department. And we are like not connected with business at all.
We are trying it from ASI level, like we are creating a SOPs.
Uh-huh.
We are listing out all the forms what investors can go in one place.
But
you know?
It's not
so
the job of business. But this is not the job of business. That's of
yeah,
the government, no? Sir,
from
both finished last.
There is a lot of ease of doing business which has already been started in terms of, you know, faceless assessments, faceless appeals. These are part of these things. And I think this budget takes forward that particular process. So that over a period of, I think, next couple of years, both in direct taxes or indirect taxes, I think there will be a huge amount of ease of doing business. We are already experiencing this.
Yeah.
Basically, what we have been seeing over our experience of GST or in the earlier regime is the approach towards tax culture was always in a little indisciplined way.
Yeah, and it was
so
like
somewhere the businesses also have to be a little more disciplined in their record keeping and their compliances. So, like for example, even nil returns people don't file on time, and then they want a relief from the late fees.
Correct.
Whereas the government has brought an SMS-based nil return filing process. So, if these advantages are taken and the infrastructure, as he pointed out, infrastructure for business externally is affected, but internally if they can make it more upfront or a little more alert or diligent in their aspect, I think indirect taxes is the GST is the right law for this country going forward, and jointly with the associations, the businesses can represent for a better change.
I think we are all for better. One thing for which we should thank the Honorable Finance Minister is for giving 300 crores to Goa for the celebration of 60th.
This I thought Ralph would bring up, but he didn't.
I'm sure all of us would be rejoicing. The way it should be utilized for the welfare of the state. That is one part. But secondly, what you said very rightly, maximizing governance is the key and the sixth pillar of this budget. So this has to be taken up because it is not a concurrent issue. It is it should go parallelly with the state as well as the center. And I think both in tandem will work towards better achieving the means of this budget.
Yes, now we have had a discussion, though of course time constraints are always an issue. I would like to thank GCCI for allowing us to hold this debate. We are in GCCI right now, they just finished the discussion, and I would like to thank GCCI in association with 365 that has allowed us to have a debate. All the top leaders in various fields are here with us. Thank you all, and I hope that whenever we see a budget, it's always optimism. So last time there was the COVID, so hopefully this time a lot of whatever is said in the budget is actually put in practice, especially ease of doing business. But the optimism is there. I'm up. Thank you for watching.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for watching, and keep watching Goa 365.